This program raises questions. This program is for people who find it hard to trust God. The best answers are wrapped in flesh and blood. My friends, people who are enduring real tragedies every single day. Quadriplegia, muscular dystrophy, stroke, bankruptcy, loneliness, singleness. We're going to talk to those very people who have touched my life. Hi, I'm Johnny Erickson Tata, and welcome to this second episode of the story of Charlie and Lucy Wiedemeyer. When we last met, we got an up-close and personal look at Charlie and Lucy and the way this extraordinary couple handled the onslaught of ALS, or as they call it, Lou Gehrig's disease. It was a devastating disability. In fact, so devastating that Charlie never recovered. Well, today we're going to hear from Lucy and how they were able to live life to its fullest under these extremely difficult circumstances. Well, Lucy, it's been a long time since you and I have sat together like this and talked. A few years it's been since Charlie went home to be with the Lord, and it's given you a chance to take a deep breath.
Yikes. Oh, is that right? A deep breath.
Yes.
We always used to tease Charlie about breathing because, of course, the machine had to breathe for him. We would always tell him to hold his breath when he was having anything medical that, you know, the machine would tell, say, hold your breath, and he would be laughing.
Machine would tell you that?
Mm-hmm.
I did not know that. Mm-hmm. I love what you're wearing. In the front of your shirt here, you got breathe. And what's one sleeve say again?
Inhale and exhale. In case you forget. Which,
breathe.
Yes.
Breathing's
a good
thing.
Might be possible, yes. Mm.
Lucy, Ken and I just celebrated our 30th wedding anniversary. Congratulate us.
Congratulations.
Thank
that is
you.
Very awesome.
When you've got a disability, being married that long is a great thing. It's a big thing. It's a huge thing because I look at my husband and how much time he invests, oh my goodness, in my everyday care. And I've got girlfriends helping me. I've got girlfriends helping me in the morning, helping me lay down at night. But still, it's that every day, 24/7, psychological pressure. It's not letting up, and you are the one who's the caregiver, and I'm kind of like in Charlie's position. You invested so much time in your husband so that he could invest his life in others. Did people ever recognize you for quote, standing behind the wheelchair all those years?
Actually, they did, but it's nothing I ever sought. I just, you love someone enough, you'll be there. Yeah. But people would make comments and wonder how I did it, and so it was an open door to share how.
Okay, well, then you just set yourself up for a good question. How did you do it? I mean, we're talking more intensive investment of time than my husband ever invests in me. I mean, Charlie, ventilator-dependent quadriplegic, at least I've got some use of my arms. He had no use of his body. How'd you do it?
Without the grace of God, I could not have done it. Could not have done it. And I think because, we always felt we were a team, that we would just count every day. We couldn't worry about what he would not be able to do tomorrow or next week. And we couldn't fuss over the fact that starting last week, he had lost the ability to do something. So it was trying to really focus on the day and focus outward, be more concerned about others and learning not to dwell on the situation at hand,
right?
Because so many were bombarding us as he began to lose the ability to do things.
Okay, well, I want to ask you so many things about that because for me, again, my disability, I broke my neck and that's it. My functioning ability pretty much is the same. But for Charlie, I mean, when he started out with his ALS, he had probably every day, every week, something more he'd lose. The ability to breathe, the ability to speak, the ability to move his legs, how did you deal with those little, I like to call them deaths? I mean, you have to give up stuff. You have to let go of that. How did you, in those early years, how did you deal with that?
It's amazing how God was working in my life, even before I realized it. But the hardest thing for Charlie was having been such a gifted athlete, and he was literally being robbed one thing after another. First, it was his hand. You know, he was a math teacher and he couldn't grasp the chalk. Then it was something else. And so when he was diagnosed, the doctor said he might have a year to live. New math, 33 years.
Amazing, absolutely amazing. Now, that's a cause for rejoicing. But when you're in that long middle distance, you know, at the beginning, at the starting line, there's a lot of people cheering you on. And of course, at the end, the finish line, you know, you see the end in sight, but it's that long middle distance. I know, again, I deal with this with my own quadriplegia. Sometimes I wake up in the morning and I think, oh, God, I don't have strength for this. I cannot do this. And yet, there's somebody knocking at the front door. You've got an appointment. Describe your routine. I mean, when you would wake up in the morning and...
Well, okay, many times...
you even open your eyes, when your head is on the pillow, what were you thinking?
Well, many times my head wasn't on the pillow because nights were really tough. And yet, I spent one afternoon as we took Charlie in for a doctor's appointment. My son and I were struggling to get him out of this van that we had borrowed. And I felt just this huge lump coming up in my throat. And I don't know, I had a thing, but I didn't want to cry in front of Charlie. So I zipped out of the van, went around to the back, and knelt down in a big parking lot and just cried out to God and said, I cannot do this by myself. And the comfort, you know, like a huge blanket around me. And the resolve that he gave me that day really was astonishing, so much so that when I went back and opened the door and said, okay, let's go, my husband and my son went, both of them were rather surprised. Mom, are you okay?
But you had to do that probably countless
more
times.
More than once.
What does it take? I mean, what kind of a person lives like that? What kind of resources do you need to think, okay, I'm gonna go back to in the back of the van, kneel down and pray, I need you, God. What do you have to keep reminding yourself of every day? What?
That there's a bigger picture.
I love that word. I say that all the time. I tell that to Ken all the time. What's the big picture? Let's remember the big picture.
Exactly. And the fact that we could still be out on the football field, we had to, you know, sort of constantly change. You know, there were always challenges, but we were blessed with a lot of wonderful friends who are still part of our family.
And I think maybe the big picture for a lot of people who might be watching this who, oh, I don't know, you know, they don't live public lives. They haven't written a book like Charlie and Lucy Wiedemeyer, and they don't travel and speak like Johnny and Ken. For them, the big picture could be my family's watching, my neighbors are watching, the people at the hospital and at the clinic are observing. My church is learning. We're all on display. Our lives are all on stage. And we're all being spotlighted. So no one ever lives to himself alone.
I am still astounded at the gifts that God gave us in those early times. And one day he said, I don't think you care. You never cry. I'm like, oh my goodness.
Charlie said that to you. He said you never cry.
I'm like, okay, well, as my tears start, I've been trying not to cry. And I, you know, it's interesting because communication has to be one of the biggest factors in a relationship, let alone one that has a disability. And letting each other know, you know, today my feelings were hurt. Or, you know what, this is very hard for me to see you in pain, or it's very hard to, you know, we can't fix them. And yet, their mind is still intact. You know, Charlie always said, ALS did not affect his mind, it affected his wife's mind.
Wow.
God, that was thoughtful.
Not only thoughtful, it's insightful. When you look at the photographs, when you look at the videos, when you see you out in public, you're smiling. I love Charlie's smile. What a great smile. I mean, the joy was hard fought for, but was the joy as real behind closed doors when nobody was watching, when the cameras were off of you, when the routines got incredibly daily?
Joy is a choice.
Tell us about that.
You can choose to, you know, wallow in the difficulties. But if you understand that we will all have hard times and difficulties and tough situations, but if you dwell and wallow in that, you know, you lose the joy. You're allowing your joy to be stolen. You know, if somebody does something unkind to you, or you feel you've been ignored, I mean, it's a tough go as one loses the ability to do things and you're counting on somebody else.
You mentioned about choosing joy, and Lucy, when I get up in the morning, yikes, it's just so overwhelming sometimes what I have to face with quadriplegia pain, still battling the leftovers of cancer, yada, yada, yada. And I have to take a deep breath and say, God, I have no resources for this. I have no strength for this. But you do. That's the choice, huh?
Mm-hmm. Joy comes from within and is a choice. You know, you can be bitter and angry and upset, and you have every right to be. No one would ever question that. But joy, that joy, I mean, we know we have the promise of eternal life. And so every day is an opportunity for us to be used by God.
Yeah.
Every day, no matter how upside down we might be, no matter what machine doesn't work, no matter what
caregiver doesn't show up.
Yes, right? And that happens often. Yes.
And to me, joy feels like, joy looks like this rock solid confidence that God's in charge. Okay, that's one aspect of joy. Another aspect of joy might be the ability to look on the bright side.
Yes.
The ability to have a little bit of humor.
Yes. Oh, that's very important.
Absolutely. And this contentment that you know that your soul is safe. Your body might be falling apart. The body of your spouse might be falling apart, the person you're taking care of. But our souls are safe. You know, the Bible talks about how God only does good toward us. Like, quote, no harm will befall you. Well, hello, spinal cord injury, ALS, cancer, muscular dystrophy, multiple sclerosis. I mean, there's lots of harm that befalls us. But sometimes I think we tend to get so physical. Our eyes are so physical. We don't understand the spiritual realities of what the Bible's talking about, and that is the good of our soul.
It's really fascinating looking back on how the Lord brought us through those very difficult times. That Charlie began to really see what God was doing. And he changed his prayer from God, heal me, to God, use me.
Use me. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. You know, something else that I think a caregiver does for somebody like me, a person with a disability, or Charlie, my husband has said to me on occasion, gee, Johnny, you really faced that with courage. I admire that. Oh. I mean, what words to just run on. One of the challenges of caregiving is, okay, I'm providing meals and personal care assistance to this person in a wheelchair or in bed or whatever, mm-hmm. who's depressed,
mm-hmm.
and it's depressing me. Like, how do you help? I know what Ken does to me. I mean, I know how he kicks me out of depression. But what did you do when Charlie would?
I would point to the positive things. I would point to the blessings. We have a son and a daughter. And keeping a sense of humor when we were so exhausted, because that's what happens. You don't know that you're pushing limits on in every direction.
Bingo, that's exactly what Ken and I do. Mm-hmm. As my caregiver, mm-hmm. and he's not my primary caregiver, again, I've got girlfriends who help, but it's just rehearsing all the things we can do. What can we do? We can see, feel, talk, relate, encourage, inspire, uplift, applaud. I mean, there's so many things that, mm-hmm. you know, you can do with other mm-hmm. people around you. You know, sometimes in the, what feels like a dismal, dreary routine of day-to-day tasks that never change, they never vary, you gotta do them every day as a caregiver. Joy's hard fought for. I mean, you mentioned earlier it's a choice, but what do you do to kind of garner joy, to get yourself moving in that right direction?
Sometimes it's really tough. And when you have certain personalities in your loved one that really gets magnified with illness. And my darling husband was a perfectionist. And that was a tough one because, as I mentioned, trying to do things for him, you really could never be perfect.
Because Charlie was a perfectionist, did he like only you doing his routines?
Oh, heavens, of course.
Like nobody else could do it as well as you know, his wife.
Uh-huh.
You know, so that makes it more difficult for you to welcome help through the front door because your spouse with a disability only wants you to do it.
That's a tough one because in a lot of ways, I didn't want to give that up. And yet I knew that I'd much rather be a wife than someone doing the menial chores, so to speak, on a daily basis. And I was more than exhausted, and I knew I had to make a change. And friends had done a fundraiser to get us some care. But it was a tough transition, good and bad, and everything in between.
When I first learned to welcome people into my life to help me with toileting routines, bathing routines, getting up in the wheelchair routines, I was living with my sister then, many years ago, and she said to me, "Johnny, I think God wants to teach you flexibility." And it was like, yikes, yeah, maybe he really does. Mm-hmm. And I'm so grateful that she talked turkey with me and was straight with me because it certainly helped me in my marriage.
Yes.
You know, my husband's not my caregiver primarily. I mean, he's my husband, which makes a big difference. Mm-hmm. Having a disability though, plans always go askew. And that can really be hard when you're a caregiver.
If people are bothered by the smallest things that go wrong, caregiving will catapult them into a whole new world if they thought they were having stress issues.
Before?
Yes.
You got stress issues now?
Yes. Over the top. You know, people don't come, the medication is wrong, you know, the power goes out,
and nobody understands you. I mean, nobody really gets that unless they actually are in your home, living there, and they see what these, you know, inconveniences cause you as a couple. What one nugget of advice would you give a caregiver who is just feeling
overwhelmed?
Absolutely, with a capital O.
Respite. I mean, time out. Just time out. They. I think the nugget is not to get there. Not to get so overwhelmed. And so many of us women have that sort of martyr syndrome that we can do it, you know, Florence Nightingale, the whole nine yards. And they don't want to admit that it's too hard. And some days it just is too hard.
What about for the person who feels overwhelmed and realizes they need respite, but there's nobody around to help?
That's when call your church, call social services. You know, there are lots of places to call.
Yeah.
And I think when a diagnosis comes or an injury or an accident or, you know, cancer rears its ugly head, there are more resources now than when we started our journey. And it's very important. And if they can't do it, maybe a sibling could help them do it. You know, be in touch with somebody by email.
I have a feeling that a lot of people who are giving care to a loved one feel exactly the same way. They don't want anyone feeling sorry for them or pitying them. They want to put up a good front that, you know, we can do this, we can handle this. We're not psychotic cases. Before you know it, we're crumbling in the inside or we're snapping back at our spouse. You have good days with Charlie and you had bad days with Charlie. Did you ever have, two or three days in a row, the routine's normal, we can handle this, and then crash. Something happens, something breaks, somebody doesn't show up.
Oh no, that was daily.
That was daily, okay.
And I just learned to just let it go because it would stress me out and then I would stress him out and that wasn't good.
Yeah.
And so I would just, you know,
let it go. And part of the art of letting it go, and I really think it's an art, is trusting that these little inconveniences and irritations are not out of God's purview. This is not beyond his control. He has permitted this in our lives. You know, there's a verse in the Bible that in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 9, these things happen to
us that we might not rely on ourselves,
Amen.
But on God mm-hmm. who raises mm-hmm. the dead. And when you live like that, that's life.
Oh, it is. It is. It's just amazing. Right after Charlie died, my mother's cancer just blossomed, and that's probably the best euphemism I can come up with, instead of a volcanic eruption. And I had to jump into caregiving mode.
After Charlie mm-hmm. passed away?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, my goodness.
It was very difficult. I was running her to a million doctor's appointments, CT scans, MRIs.
My goodness, you didn't skip a beat from Charlie's funeral to mm-hmm. helping your mother.
Mm-hmm. However, my mother was not as good of a patient as my husband.
Wow.
She was pretty angry. She was mad at God as she got weaker and weaker. One afternoon she said, "I think you need to pray for me." And she was lying out on the couch, so I just put my hand on her and just prayed over her, you know, and just thanked the Lord just to strengthen her, but know the peace that surpasses all understanding. And I finished, and she opened one eye, and she said, "It didn't work." I said, "I think God has more to teach you before you get to go." And he allowed us in the next few weeks to have the most precious, amazing time of reading Max Lucado's book, Fearless, and how the Bible talks much more about courage and fearlessness than about fear. And she had had some fear that as a child had always stayed stuffed down, and she was able to let go. Right in front of me. It was such a gift from the Lord to have her be able to laugh and smile her last breath and be ushered into the kingdom was an amazing gift.
What a sweet story. What a poignant story. Charlie was such a force in your life. The two of you had such an incredible nonstop 24-hour on-the-go, big picture life. Mm-hmm. What's it like now? How have you made that transition from globe-trotting travels, major, larger-than-life challenges, fix this problem fast? How do you go from that constant, operating at like 98% to a more quiet life now without your companion? How's it been?
Very difficult. More difficult than I imagined. I just thought the joy, knowing he was out of pain, out of, you know, the miserable things that would really handicap him.
Yeah. What has made it so difficult? Is it the grief? Is it the change of routine?
It is the grief. I did not grieve after he died because I was dealing with my mother. And I'm a Christian. I know where he is. I should be fine. And I duct taped myself quite well. And about a year later, the duct tape started coming off.
Wow.
And I have very dear close friends that would come and walk me. They'd make me walk. And they would just say, "Come on, we're gonna walk. We're gonna walk."
Isn't that something? Something mm-hmm. so small,
mm-hmm.
seemingly insignificant,
mm-hmm.
but incredibly
yes.
powerful.
And practical. Just love me and not expect anything. I needed replenishment. I just needed replenishment.
How's
I
that,
needed to talk
how's
to him.
How's that replenishment come?
It's amazing. Lord just, he stopped me cold and allowed me to just take baby steps. And it's been remarkable.
You know, that is such good advice for any caregiver who's perhaps lost a child with a disability, or you, a spouse, losing your spouse with a disability. Take life in baby steps. Mm-hmm. The grief will always be there.
Oh, yes.
It'll just look different a year from now.
That's
but you'll still
so
be
true.
Dealing with it.
Mm-hmm.
Small little things will trigger mm-hmm. you off, little memories.
Mm-hmm.
How would you advise somebody to move forward who is struggling with the loss of that one they've been caring for so long?
It's very important to know that you need to let that grief just run you over and let the tears come. And just know that the Lord is holding you and that you need to be still and wait. And he will direct your path. And I'm beginning to see that light.
So Do you resent people who just look at you as Lucy now? You're Lucy. You're not, no longer is it Charlie and Lucy.
A lot of people talk about me finding myself and, you know, having freedom. And I have to bite my tongue not to laugh because I don't feel that way. And I realize it's okay that I can say we, and I do. It's really awesome. When I look back and see how the Lord carried us so many times, you know, it's like those footprints in the sand, all the times that he carried us. But I don't feel it's party of one.
Yeah, it's and just, the story continues.
Yes.
You know, it's fun, Lucy, it's fun to think that now Charlie's story continues with this television program. It's
Amen,
a wonderful
sister.
Thing.
There's
a whole,
I just love it that you're doing this.
Well, it's a whole generation out there who don't know the Wiedemeyer story. And I'm very grateful to you for helping us tell it.
Oh, well, we love you so much. And see, I still say we because you're still with me.
There you go, we.
I hope you could tell from my conversation with Lucy that giving care to someone with a disability, whether a spouse, an elderly parent, a child, can be quite challenging. But also, as you learned, there are many blessings that come with caregiving, not the least of which is that you learn to depend on God every single day. Caregiving does not allow you to leave God out of the picture. No. If people like Lucy and my husband Ken want to keep a good attitude, then they have to hold fast to Colossians chapter 3, verses 23 to 25, where it says, "Whatever you do, work at it with all your heart, as working for the Lord, not for men, since you know that you will receive an inheritance from the Lord as a reward. It is the Lord Christ you are serving." Wow. For all those years Lucy helped her dear husband, and for all the years Ken has been helping me, they really have been serving Jesus. Not a thing they've done will go unrewarded. Every hour that they've invested, day or nighttime routines, all of it, is stretching their soul's capacity for heavenly reward. All of it is increasing Lucy and Ken's eternal capacity for joy, worship, and service in heaven. That is a powerful perspective. And caregivers need help from the body of Christ in order to keep that focus, to keep their attitude bright. So find out ways your church can minister to caregivers by contacting us at johnnyandfriends.org. For when you support the work of a caregiver, when you lend a hand and offer help, you will receive a special inheritance as a reward as well. For you too will be serving Jesus Christ. Find out more at johnnyandfriends.org. And thanks for joining me for this special episode of Johnny and Friends.
This program was made possible by support from generous people like you. This episode of Johnny and Friends is available on a two-part DVD set for $15.95 at johnnyandfriendstv.org.